We've all seen some alarming headlines about antibiotic resistance. Top medical experts are talking about a possible antibiotic apocalypse, or Armageddon. The World Health Organization is saying we are facing a post-antibiotic future. Antibiotic resistance is already increasing, and scientists say that in the UK, deaths due to infectious disease could triple in the next 10 years. If we don't take action, it's forecast that deaths due to antibiotic resistance will increase from 700,000 a year worldwide to 10 million a year by 2050. This will be more than the current numbers of deaths due to cancer. And there will be huge economic costs too. Between now and 2050, antibiotic resistance could cost the world economy $100 trillion. But even though all of these experts are saying we really need to reduce our use of antibiotics, the reality is that worldwide, most antibiotics are not even used in human medicine. According to the latest estimates, over 70% of antibiotics used globally are used in farm animals. And if we continue to increase our meat consumption, scientists say that farm antibiotic use globally will increase by another 50% by 2030. Now, remarkably, we've known about the dangers of antibiotic resistance for a long time. Alexander Fleming, who discovered penicillin, was already warning us of this in his Nobel Prize acceptance speech in 1945. And he was particularly concerned that we avoid using antibiotics at very low doses, also called subtherapeutic doses, as this is most likely to lead to antibiotic resistance. But despite this, in the 1950s, most countries around the world decided to allow farmers to add antibiotics to animal feed at very low doses, precisely the doses that Fleming had warned against. And this was done because it was found to make the animals grow faster. Now, at the time, many scientists and even politicians realized that this was a really bad idea. And when Britain decided to legalize growth promotion in 1953, one MP said in Parliament, "May I ask whether we have all gone mad to want to give penicillin to pigs to fatten them? Why not give them good food, as God meant them to have?" So why did we do it? Well, at the time, scientists were discovering many new types of antibiotics. So if resistance occurred to some of them, that didn't seem too much of a worry. From 1940 to 1980, scientists discovered 22 new families of antibiotics. But this golden age of antibiotic discovery has now ended. And in the last 30 years, we have failed to discover and develop a single new family of antibiotics. That's none in 30 years. And this is why there is now so much concern about antibiotic resistance. So what is antibiotic resistance? Well, we need to understand that it's bacteria that become resistant, not people or animals. And when an antibiotic is used against a bacterial infection, there will often be some of the bacteria that have a genetic mutation that makes them resist the antibiotic. That's the purple bacteria in this picture. And the antibiotic kills off the sensitive ones, and the resistant ones survive and multiply and spread. And so gradually, the antibiotic loses its ability to harm bacteria, particularly when it's overused. So can the farm use of antibiotics contribute to resistance in human infections? Well, most of the resistance in human infections is probably due to the medical use of antibiotics, but not all of it. There is also clear scientific evidence that the farm use of antibiotics contributes significantly to the problem. And this is happening even with some of the most important antibiotics we have, including last resort antibiotics used to treat life-threatening infections. So what happens is that when the animals are fed antibiotics, some of the bacteria in their guts can develop resistance. And then at slaughter, the carcasses can become contaminated and the bacteria end up on meat. And then when we eat, we handle raw meat or eat undercooked meat, these bacteria can be transmitted to us and contribute to resistant infections. Also, when manure or slurry from animals fed antibiotics is spread on the land, the crops and drinking water can be contaminated, and we will then receive these bacteria and residues. So, what was human medicine like before we had antibiotics? Well, this is a photo of my uncle, Phelim Sweetman. And in 1944, when he was just 2 and a half, he developed appendicitis, and he had to be operated on in Wexford, in Ireland. But unfortunately, the operation didn't go well, and he developed peritonitis and died. Now, at the time, penicillin still wasn't widely available, so he didn't receive any antibiotics. Had he received antibiotics, he might still have been alive today. Now, stories like this would have been common in the pre-antibiotic era. At the beginning of the 20th century, over 40% of deaths in the UK were of infants and of children aged under 14. But thanks to really big improvements in hygiene, in vaccination, and thanks to the discovery of antibiotics, child mortality has now fallen to less than 1% of all deaths. Antibiotics have helped treat serious infections like tuberculosis, pneumonia, septicemia. But they've also contributed to a wider revolution in human medicine. Patients undergoing surgery or cancer chemotherapy are often more prone to serious infection and may require preventative antibiotics. Without antibiotics, all of this could be under threat. So antibiotics have been of huge benefit to human health, but they haven't benefited animal health in the same way. Sometimes antibiotics are used to treat individual sick animals, and this can be a completely appropriate use of antibiotics. But in intensive farming, antibiotics are mainly used for mass medication as a productivity tool. Growth promotion has now been banned in Europe and in many countries around the world. But most of these countries still permit mass medication for disease prevention and control. And in Europe, this still accounts for 90% of all farm antibiotic use. And in some cases, the same antibiotics that were used for growth promotion are used for disease prevention. So really, the growth promoting ban changed very little. Preventative antibiotics enable some farmers to keep very high numbers of animals, particularly pigs and poultry, indoors in highly intensive conditions, as you see in this picture of a chicken farm. And these conditions are highly unhealthy, but yet they still get rapid growth. But antibiotics increase productivity in other ways. Chickens have been genetically selected for rapid growth and can now reach their slaughter weight in just 5 weeks, whereas in the 1950s, it took 4 months to reach the same weight. But this rapid growth causes them health problems, which antibiotics are used to control. Pig farmers will sometimes wean their piglets very early so that the sow can produce another litter as quickly as possible. But this causes the piglets to develop diarrhea that antibiotics are used to control. Dairy cows have also been bred for high productivity, and the average dairy cow in the UK now produces over 3 times as much milk a year as they did in the 1940s. But this makes them much more prone to mastitis, and their very large udders can make it difficult for them to stand straight on their hind legs, thus causing more lameness. Again, antibiotics are used to control these problems. So antibiotics have enabled us to push intensively farmed animals very hard. but they've also enabled a huge increase in global meat consumption, particularly in the consumption of meat from pigs and poultry, which tend to be the most intensively farmed and receive the highest levels of antibiotics. Global consumption of chicken meat has increased over 10 times since the 1960s. But this large number of extra animals requires lots of grain, and in the countries with the most intensively farmed animals, most of the grain that is grown now goes to feed livestock, not humans. In Europe, it's 55%. In the United States, it's over 65%. But to grow all of this extra grain, we've had to expand and intensify our crop growing. And this is now widely recognized as having a huge adverse effect on wildlife. At the beginning of the 20th century, the global weight of livestock was about twice the global weight of all terrestrial vertebrate wildlife. But now, it's 25 times larger. As livestock populations have grown, wildlife has shrunk. So, what can we do about this? Well, a small number of countries in Europe have already banned routine preventative antibiotic use. And some others, like the UK, are starting to reduce it and to phase it out. The World Health Organization has recently called for a global ban on preventative antibiotic use. And currently, the European Union is considering a ban along those lines. And the really good news is that when we make significant cuts to antibiotic use, rates of resistance tend to stop increasing and even start falling again. But many of these cuts are still too small and too slow. And if we want to make really big cuts to farm antibiotic use, we need to improve the way we farm animals so that their health and welfare is given more importance. We know that intensively farmed animals can receive up to 20 times more antibiotics than animals raised outdoors. We will also need to eat less meat and less dairy, but less meat, but better quality meat from animals raised without routine antibiotic use. Pasture-fed animals, animals raised with access to the outdoors, organically farmed animals, all tend to have fewer disease problems and far less need for antibiotics. We need to avoid putting pressure on our doctors to prescribe antibiotics unnecessarily. But we do need to put pressure on our governments to act. The resistance problem is global. Bacteria spread globally. We are all connected through international travel and through the international trade in meat. So we need international action and cooperation. We need to be setting ambitious targets for reducing antibiotic use. And this issue is so serious, we need a global treaty like we have for greenhouse gas emissions. We all want to avoid an antibiotic apocalypse and a return to a time when people die from simple infections. So we need to act now. Our health and the health of future generations demands that we do no less. Thank you.